In July 1975, as the Soviet Soyuz 19 was on its 35th orbit of the Earth and American Apollo 18 was on its 29th, the two spacecraft docked and their crews met and exchanged keepsakes. Watched by the world, this historic docking lasted 2 days and was seen by many as the beginning of the end of the space race. This simulation of the proposed Alpha space station shows how it will look once it is fully assembled, with the 20 separate modules together covering the length of a football pitch. As astronauts step inside, this will be their first view of the interior. Here you can see a model of the proposed US laboratory equipped for conducting experiments in weightlessness. The living quarters will include all space-age comforts, such as this microgravity toilet. As part of the Lunar series, the Soviets developed a robotic roving vehicle called Lunokhod. Operated from an Earth-based control station, Lunokhod 1, seen here as a prototype on Earth, landed on the Moon in November 1970. It drilled and tested soil samples and returned television pictures of the lunar surface. The V-2 rocket was the first ballistic missile. Developed by a team of German engineers, it was built with the aid of concentration camp slave labor during World War II. This massive weapon was designed by Wernher von Braun, later the chief architect of the American space program. Its one-ton warhead was aimed at London and Antwerp before its last launch site was overrun in the spring of 1945. In December 1993, NASA astronauts were sent into space on a special mission to repair and service the Hubble Space Telescope. Orbiting 595 kilometers above the Earth, the astronauts spent 2 days installing corrective mirrors, replacing solar panels, and carrying out general maintenance. Once this work had been done and the telescope had been returned to its usual orbit, astronomers were able to observe the universe in greater detail than ever before. Former Soviet test pilot Yuri Gagarin was the first person in space. On the 12th of April 1961, he blasted off in Vostok 1 and completed a single orbit of the Earth in a flight lasting 108 minutes. He immediately became a national hero. Newspapers spread the word of his achievement worldwide, proclaiming, "He returns from the sky." 6 years after its launch, as Galileo approached Jupiter in July 1995, it launched an atmospheric probe. In December 1995, Galileo flew by Jupiter's third largest moon, Io, and then went into orbit around Jupiter while the atmospheric probe descended by parachute. The probe discarded its heat shield and began to send back information to Galileo about the chemical composition and physical state of the planet's atmosphere, until it was crushed by pressure 57 minutes later. Skylab was built from the third stage of an unused Saturn V rocket, with its hydrogen tank converted into two-story accommodation and workspace. The bottom section contained living quarters, where the crew relaxed and slept. Meals were put together from the 72 different types of food in the freezer. The top section housed a spacious workshop where, as well as conducting experiments in weightlessness, astronauts found the conditions perfect for acrobatics. After passing through the orbit of Mars and examining the asteroid belt, Pioneer 10 encountered Jupiter in December 1973. The craft carried an instrument on its 21.5-foot boom to study the interplanetary magnetic field, and it also studied the solar wind. Pioneer took the first ever close-up images of the giant planet and some of its moons. 10 years later, it became the first craft to leave the solar system. Many of the ordinary things we do on Earth become extraordinary in the weightless environment of a spacecraft. Washing one's hair is no longer a simple task when nothing seems to fall into place. Here, an astronaut adds salt and pepper to a meal. This seasoning has been prepared in squirtable form because normal salt and pepper would drift away. At the end of a working day, astronauts retire to their sleeping quarters for some well-earned rest. If it were possible to drive a car to the moon, the journey would take about 200 days. In a Saturn V rocket, the journey takes only about 3 days. Between 1969 and 1972, six crews of US astronauts successfully landed on the moon. Their first-hand explorations of the moon have allowed us to analyze the surface of our nearest neighbor and to determine its history, including the reasons for the extensive cratering on its surface. The marks left on the moon's dusty surface by the astronauts will remain for millions of years. It is an airless world, so there is no weather to disturb footprints or the tracks left by moon buggies. This computer-generated image of Venus was created using radar data from the Magellan space probe. This journey begins with a flight over a 1,000-kilometer-long rift valley in Venus's northern hemisphere. Ahead is Gula Mons, one of Venus's many volcanoes. On the other side of its summit are many bright streams of solidified lava. The journey continues over the jagged ridges of Alpha Regio, a highland region in the southern hemisphere, and finishes with a view of a small crater unofficially named the Tick. The surface of Mars is scarred by craters, volcanoes, and canyons. This computer-generated journey begins at the eastern entrance to a huge system of canyons called Valles Marineris, which is 4 times deeper and 10 times longer than the Grand Canyon in the United States. Ahead is a row of 3 volcanoes. The first, Arcia Mons, is topped by a crater wider than the American city of Los Angeles. These volcanoes are far larger than any on Earth. From Earth, Mars appears reddish because large areas of its surface, especially its broad, sweeping plains, are covered in red iron oxide dust, commonly known as rust. In this external simulation, you can see the shuttle orbiter move towards Mir. The orange object in the shuttle's payload bay is the specially installed docking port. Here you can see the view from this docking port as the shuttle approaches the space station. The dark target area inside the Mir docking port is used to keep the shuttle centered on its approach. After the docking, Shuttle Commander Robert Gibson ensured that the air pressure inside the shuttle matched that of Mir before opening the hatch. He was greeted by Mir Commander Vladimir Dezerov.
30 feet, 2.5 down. Great shadow. 4 forward, drift into the right a little. 30, 2.5.
30 seconds.
Forward, drift. Ready. Contact light.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
That's one small step for man. One giant leap for mankind.
This simulation shows Cassini arriving at Saturn in June 2004 in order to study its atmosphere, rings, magnetic field, and its largest moon, Titan. As Cassini flies past Titan, it will release the probe Huygens. The Cassini orbiter will map Titan's surface with radar during several flybys. Huygens will enter Titan's atmosphere and make a 2-hour descent by parachute. It will send back to Cassini information about Titan's atmosphere and surface and possible life-forming molecules. On the 3rd of June 1965, Ed White became the first American to walk in space. Tethered to the Gemini 4 craft, White spent 22 minutes spacewalking using a handheld rocket gun to maneuver himself. 18.5 years later, Bruce McCandless achieved another first when he became the first astronaut to use a manned maneuvering unit in space. Untethered, the astronaut propelled himself 50 meters away from the space shuttle Challenger before returning to the craft. This ComStar communications satellite is being launched from the payload bay of the space shuttle Endeavour. The shuttle releases the satellite from its cradle using springs. ComStar will then use its own rocket engine to maneuver into its proper operational orbit. ComStar will occupy a slot in geostationary orbit at a height of 36,000 kilometers above the Earth's equator.
Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, zero. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
Roger, we got a roll program.
Tower cleared.
Roger, roll.
Houston, Apollo 11, this is the magnificent ride.
As the sun rotates, the lines of its magnetic field become wound up and burst through the sun's surface. They then cause violent solar activity, ejecting billions of tons of hot gases outwards to form prominences. Even more violent solar activity sends streams of energetic particles towards the Earth, which can cause disturbances in the supply of electricity and interruption of radio signals. As the gases fall back to the sun from its outer atmosphere, or corona, they may break up and form what is known as coronal rain. A solar eclipse can be observed from only a tiny proportion of the Earth's surface at any one time. During a total solar eclipse, the sun's photosphere, or visible surface, is completely hidden by the moon. The sun's outer atmosphere, or corona, then becomes visible, as can be seen in this time-lapse film. As the photosphere comes back into view, a beautiful diamond ring effect can be seen. Images of the Earth taken from space allow us a complete view of huge structures in the Earth's crust and atmosphere. Here, the Gulf of Aden is visible between Africa and Asia. Here, we see the northeast coast of Australia with the sunlight reflecting off the sea. And here a formation of clouds can be seen around the eye of Hurricane Florence. The center of this view shows the Ganges River as it flows through India, which appears grayish blue from space. On the right is the snow-capped Himalayan mountain range, which formed when India collided with the rest of Asia due to continental drift. Voyager 2 arrived at Jupiter in July 1979 and made a close examination of its atmosphere and its moons. It reached Saturn in August 1981, observing its many rings of ice and dust before taking a gravity assist at Saturn to arrive at Uranus in January 1986. In August 1989, it flew by Neptune, discovering six new moons and gathering data on Neptune's very faint ring system and its largest moon, Triton. On its long journey, Voyager 2 continued to communicate information about the Sun's energy field back to Earth. It was still sending this information as it left the planetary solar system. The US space shuttle takes off like a rocket, with a large external tank supplying fuel to the shuttle's engines. Additional power is supplied by two solid propellant rocket boosters. The boosters burn for 2 minutes and then separate from the shuttle, parachuting down for reuse. Just before reaching Earth orbit, the shuttle's main engines switch off and the external tank separates, breaking up in the Earth's atmosphere and falling into the sea. The US space shuttle lands on a runway. Unlike an aeroplane, the shuttle lands without engine power, gliding down gracefully at twice the landing speed of a 747 jumbo jet. In the final stage of the landing, the pilot deploys a parachute to slow the shuttle down and uses conventional brakes to bring it to a halt on the runway. During the early days of space flight, prospective astronauts were subjected to tremendous strains as scientists attempted to gauge how much force the human body could withstand on takeoff and how it would behave once in space. Space travelers, past and present, have had their first brief tastes of weightlessness in a specially adapted aeroplane, known as the Vomit Comet among trainee astronauts. The plane travels up at a very steep angle, suddenly switching to a very steep downwards angle. This causes the occupants to become weightless for about 20 seconds. Jupiter's cloud bands appear to travel around the planet at different rates and in two directions. One explanation for this is that each of the swirling eddies in Jupiter's atmosphere drives bands of gas above and below the eddy in opposite directions. The bands of gas then flow alternately east and west between the planet's equator and poles. The largest eddy in Jupiter's atmosphere is the Great Red Spot, which rotates once every 12 days. It is essential for an astronaut to maintain muscle tone in the weightless environment of space, where everyday tasks do not place the same demands on the body as they would on the Earth. Strapping themselves into custom-built machines, astronauts exercise for up to 2 hours a day to minimize the wasting effect that long-term weightlessness has on the human body.